Imagine the following. After weeks of cancellations, you and three friends have finally gotten together to continue the D&D campaign you're running. And things get exciting fast. Upon entering a dungeon, one friend sets off a trap. Since this friend is playing a very squishy wizard, you decide the trap will target someone at random. You know, to give them a chance. To select which of your friends has to dodge, you pull out your standard D6. But before you can make the roll, the wizard says, "Wait, we can use my new D3," and pulls out a small 3D printed dragon. This thing can't possibly be a fair die, right? Well, according to the mathematicians who designed it, it totally is. And using their method, you can design pretty much any die you want, whether it's for D&D or any other game. This dragon D3 looks nothing like a normal die, but that doesn't mean it can't be. Anything can be a die. It just needs a limited number of orientations or sides to land on. In fact, dice weren't always so regularly shaped. In ancient Greece and Rome, people used the ankle bones of animals like sheep and goats as four-sided dice. These asymmetric d4s, known as knuckle bones, were used in games and divination. Unfortunately, these particular dice had unequal probabilities. Each side did not have the same chance of landing face up. After all, Mother Nature didn't exactly have dice in mind when designing bones, but the people who used them likely didn't care, because they thought dice outcomes were controlled by fate, not math. Eventually, though, people realized probability was a thing and looked into making dice fair. The most straightforward approach to making a fair die is to use a symmetrical shape with a consistent material throughout. Many dice use this approach, including those in D&D, a game famous for using wacky dice to randomly determine players' actions and story outcomes. Now, I know a lot of you dice goblins out there have got at least one die that's a bit fancier, with insides that are clearly made of different materials like these, but that makes it way harder to ensure they're balanced. So whether you actually use them in your campaigns or just let them sit on your shelf because they're pretty, feel free to share them with us. The standard D&D dice set comes with 7 dice and 6 different isohedral shapes, meaning they have the same geometry on all sides. There's the D20 with triangle faces, 2 D10s with diamond faces, a D12 with pentagon faces, a D8 that looks like 2 back-to-back pyramids, your classic D6 cube, and a D4 that's a painfully sharp pyramid. Totally not speaking from experience here. Some of you out there may also own a non-standard die that isn't isohedral, but still has some symmetry. For example, this version of a D3 is rotationally symmetric, and so is this one. But if we want to evaluate the fairness of something like this D3 dragon, we need a more rigorous procedure. One way is to just roll a die thousands of times. A person named Jason Mills did just that in 1987 to test the non-standard D100, a die sometimes used in D&D in place of those 2 D10s, and he showed the D100 was, in fact, unfair. Alternatively, you can use computer simulations to virtually roll a die over and over and over again to get its outcome probabilities. But these simulations require intense computing power and time, and sometimes they give impossible outcomes, like having a die land on an edge. I guess it's technically not impossible that a perfect die could land exactly on its edge, but even the slightest nudge would send it tumbling over, which we will actually be getting back to later. Thanks to Rocket Money for supporting this SciShow video. Last year, the engine in my car exploded, and you kind of need a working engine if you want to drive a car, so I've been saving up to buy a new one. And I keep track of my money with Rocket Money, the personal finance app that allows you to manage subscriptions, lower bills, make a custom budget, and grow your savings all in one place. I am genuinely excited to talk about Rocket Money because I've been a customer for several years, and I really enjoy this app. I was a little bit of a mess financially before I started using Rocket Money to budget and keep track of my expenses because there was just no reality where I used a spreadsheet to do that stuff. I love how Rocket Money auto-categorizes my purchases into buckets of rent or groceries or shopping and medical without me having to create a whole system to do that. It also shows me on a calendar when I get paid next and when my bills are due so I can keep track of that very important timeline. It just genuinely keeps me a lot more organized. I'm already benefiting from Rocket Money, but I'm telling you now because you can try Rocket Money out today and unlock even more features with Premium. Just scan the QR code or click the link in the description to get started for free. Recently, a team of researchers came up with a new way to model dice probabilities that sticks to real-world outcomes and is between 60 and 400 times faster than simulations. Their method uses math to analyze the geometry of a die, no simulations required, although it is a bit of a simplification. For example, they ignore momentum, so each die roll is really more of a gentle placement of the die on a random edge, corner, or face, and then watching it fall over. But while critics have complained about how unhinged this method can be pretty accurate. Here's how the math works. First, we figure out all of the possible ways a die can land, which we call stable equilibrium points. Next, for each possible starting point on the die, every edge, corner, and face, we figure out which stable equilibrium point it'll eventually land on by looking at how the die will roll. Because of gravity, the die will roll in whichever direction minimizes the height of its center of mass, or balance point. In other words, it always tries to get its center of mass as close to whatever surface you're rolling the die on, be it a table or one of the collapsible felt dice trays you're using to protect all of your fancy dice from that very hard table. Now remember, this method involves a bit of simplification. Our next step is to simplify the shape of our die. Whatever it starts as, be it a cube or a dragon, we turn it into a sphere. To determine the direction that the die will roll, we map each point on the die's surface to a point on this sphere, and then plot how far it is from the center of mass using colors. In a way, we're making a spherical topographic map with light-colored peaks and dark-colored valleys. The jargon term for this is a Gauss map. From a given starting point on our Gauss map, we simply have to trace a downwards path towards a valley until the die reaches a stable equilibrium point. Finally, to determine how likely it is for our die to land in each possible orientation, we take our Gauss map and divide it into these sort of basins, each corresponding to a single outcome. The probability of landing on one outcome is just the fraction of an area that the basin covers on the sphere. If our D3 is fair, it should have three basins, each covering 33 1/3% of the sphere's total surface area. If one basin were a bit bigger and another a bit smaller, it would be unfair. According to this research team, the dragon they designed is indeed fair using these Gauss maps. And to help seal the deal, they also 3D printed the die and verified its fairness in real life by rolling it 400 times. But the researchers' math isn't just useful for analyzing dice, it can also be used to design fair dice of any shape. We only need to feed the computer a shape we like, and it can iteratively calculate the die's probabilities and tweak its shape until the Gauss map says it's fair. In addition to the aforementioned dragon, the research team used their method to design this oddly buff armadillo man and this large-headed kitten. Both of them were also D3s. They then rolled these dice several hundred times to verify their fairness. But this method doesn't just allow a person playing a warlock to design and 3D print a die shaped like their patron. We can also use this method to design dice that are intentionally unfair. For example, the researchers made several D11s with the same probability distribution of rolling two D6s, which you have to do in a bunch of board games or at a craps table. Rolling a 2 has a 1 in 36 chance because you have to get a 1 on both dice. Meanwhile, rolling a 7 has a 1 in 6 chance, which is why the robber moves so dosh garn much in Catan. Oh, and by the way, if you are itching to try any of these weird dice out, the researchers have posted the files online. That's why we have these nifty props. Now, we've talked a lot about designing multi-sided dice, and all you dice goblins out there may be excited to accrue the weirdest set of dice that best appeals to your personal taste or your DM's awkward homebrew. But what about the ultimate sits-on-the-shelf die? The ultimate cheater's die that throws the entire concept of fairness out the window because it always lands with the same face up? What if you want a D1? What could that possibly look like? Well, one option is a Mobius strip, a shape famous for only having one surface, so every side is the same side. Another option is the Gumbuts, which looks kind of like a cylinder with one side pinched off. The Gumbuts only has one stable equilibrium point, so no matter how you place it, it eventually rolls back to this upright position. It also technically has one unstable equilibrium point, that super sharp edge, but as I mentioned earlier, even if you you can technically balance it on that edge, it won't stay there for long in the real world, so it's effectively AD1. As weird as the Gumbuts looks, it's not entirely unnatural. Some tortoise shells are imperfect versions of this shape to help the animals right themselves when they accidentally flip over. Neither the Mobius strip or the Gumbuts look like a classic polyhedral die, though. If we get creative with the material, we can also make a D1 out of an isohedral shape. Recently, mathematicians made a four-sided tetrahedron act like a D1 by adding just the right amount of extra weight to one of its sides. The possibilities for dice are endless, so if someone whips out a miniature beholder in your next D&D session and claims it's their new D20, don't be so quick to discount it. It might actually be fair game.